Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to yet another live question and answer session on Hinduism. My name is Nishit Kotak. I'm here with Jay Lakhani. Jay Bhai is somebody who's very experienced in Hinduism. He's been teaching a lot of students about Hinduism for many, many years. And what I'd like you to do is please do let us know where you're watching the live broadcast from, or if you're catching the replay, let us know where you're watching it from. It does help us to understand where our audience demographics are, so that we can help to answer any questions that you may have on Hinduism. Jay Bhai, what I'd like you to do is just start off with a little topic on the social dimensions of Hinduism. So folks, I'll let you know how the format of this live stream normally is. We meet once a week on a Saturday, 2 o'clock at UK time, and it lasts for about 40 to 45 minutes. We have a few first minutes by Jay Bhai talking on a section on Hinduism, so just an educational section. And thereafter, we go into a question and answer section. I've got a whole lot of questions that you, as the viewers, have posted to us before. And I will also be live online checking your messages and answering the questions live where possible. So Jay Bhai, if you could get started with that topic of social dimensions of Hinduism.
Okay, Nish Bhai, you see, in the last few weeks I've been talking about the different dimensions of all world religions. The most central dimension from where religions spring up is the experiential dimension. Some personality, mystic, a prophet, etc., has some magical experience which gives him a glimpse into deeper reality, which is essentially spiritual. So this is the starting point, experiential dimension. Then you see the person, the prophet, whoever, will try and put some kind of linguistic ploy to try and give expression to his experience. And this turns into, if you like, the narrative related to that religion. The narrative can vary. It can be the direct utterances of the prophets, or sometimes some colorful narrative stories that are kind of generated to put across these ideas. This is the second dimension. The third dimension is, if you like, the philosophic dimension. We like to see, okay, the prophet is talking about this and that. Does it make sense? Are these ideas, you know, sensible? Are they rational? Do they sit well with each other, etc.? So the third dimension is the philosophic dimension. And the fourth dimension all religions have is, if you like, the ritual dimension. Don't forget, rituals kind of are like a continuous reminder of the spiritual dimension that we all possess. Then the fifth dimension is the ethical and moral dimension. How do these teachings influence the way you live your life and how you interact with other human beings? It's the fifth dimension. The last one is actually a killer. It's the social dimension. People may think, well, this is how society reacts to the idea of religion, and this is the social dimension. This sounds fair enough. But in reality, there's a deeper idea that must be kind of, in a way, investigated or explored in this talk. Social dimension has a habit of compromising a deeper vision of religion. Social dimension come with this kind of severe limitation and severe drawback. Because in fact, the moment this religious ideas kind of try and enter society, the society has a good habit of turning it, you know, kind of upside down. I'll just give you some examples of Hinduism, in Hinduism, where this has happened and this has caused tremendous problem. For example, the idea of caste was simply division of labor based on your age and ability. This is the idea in the Purushukta, the scripture of authority. In no time, when it comes into society, it gets compromised. And we already talked about it, but I'll just touch on it again. This idea becomes hereditary, because essence is natural for, you know, human beings to try and pass on their skills to the next generation. So it turns into a hereditary system. See, it's a social dimension to ideas of spirituality. Then this other thing, it becomes hierarchical. You know, we are more elite, more clever than you, and we know how to do the rituals. So it becomes elitist and creates, if you like, this kind of divisive idea of hierarchy. So it turns to hereditary, hierarchical caste system. See, this is the social aspect that in a way interferes with the pure vision of spirituality. But let me touch on two other areas which perhaps nobody's asked me questions on, but they're important. People say, Mr. Lakhani, you know, we had this idea of sati tradition. Means when a husband dies, the wife has to, you know, kill herself in the funeral pyre and embrace, you know, this kind of death, horrible death. Is it in our religion? Is it somewhere in the teachings of Hinduism or the prophets that the wives have to follow the husband? The answer is no. This is again the social aspect that has been done tremendous harm to Hinduism, the dignity of Hinduism, and the dignity of women. Let me give the background to both the Sati tradition as well as the child marriages. Why are children married off at the age of 4, 5, 6? You know, come on, it's ludicrous. So let me touch on both of these. First of all, the Sati tradition as well, you know, kind of getting children married at very young age started, you'll be very surprised to hear this, nothing to do with Hinduism. When the Muslim invaders came to India and they succeeded in conquering, you know, a particular kingdom, the queen, etc., were asked to kind of become the concubines of the conquering Muslim king. Either they are sold off in slaves or have to kind of sleep in the bed of the person who has just killed the husband. So many women decided rather than lose their dignity, they rather jump in the funeral pyre of their husband and kill themselves. These are the words Sati, because the very mythological story about Sati jumping in the fire and, you know, killing herself. So they use the word Sati appeared. This is just Hindu women trying to maintain their dignity and prepare to kill themselves rather than fall in the hands of the enemy. This is how it started. See, it has got nothing with Hinduism, just the dignity of womankind. So it's a very powerful thing to say. But then, see, this is the, okay, the Muslims are not ruling us, they have not been ruling India for the last 200 years or 250 years, and still the Sati tradition seemed to be going on. And when the British came, they said, oh, this is Hinduism, horrible. How did it carry on? You see, this is how the social dimension in a way compromises the deeper vision of religion. It's the society says, ah, it is such a nice thing for my rich man and my son has died at early age, so let me send the wife to look after my son in the hereafter. So they were actually pushing the women, the widows, to take their own lives. This is a horrible thing we're doing. See, it has got nothing with Muslim invasion. Muslims were not going to kidnap the women. And yet, this is how it carried on. It became a social dimension to tradition and done tremendous harm to the dignity of women as well as to Hinduism itself. That's why the word Sati comes with Hinduism. It is, if you like, a social misuse of a very simple idea. They were just protecting their dignity, but the ordinary women, when the husband dies, don't have to jump in the funeral pyre, but they were prodded to do that. It's a social phenomena, you know, but that man next door, when his son died, the wife went, so why can't my, you know, daughter-in-law also die? This is how it turns into a social, nasty, you know, kind of, I'm telling you, the social dimension can be highly damaging. This is one thing. The second thing, child marriages. You might think Hindus actually, until about 100 years, they were getting children married off at a very young age. What was all that about? Let me give you the background. Again, when the Muslim invasion took place, the Muslims were allowed to kind of capture, you know, kind of take away Hindu young ladies, girls, even who were perhaps 12, 13 year old, and make them their concubines. They just take them away as slaves. They could just pick them up and take them away. But one thing in Islam is that they were not allowed to take on married women. So in order to protect the little girls from being abducted by the invaders, the Hindus in that particular period were trying to protect the little daughters. So they say, let's get them married off at a young age. So we say, they are married, you can't take them away. So this is how it started. Nothing to do with Hinduism, of getting children married off at the age of 5. But it was a protective measure taken during the Muslim invasion. Fair enough. Now the Muslims have stopped invading us. And for the last 200 years, the British were ruling us. And still, these child marriages were going on. So again, what has happened? The social dimension kicks in. It has become a habit now, and a mechanical habit that we have kind of inherited from, you know, from the Muslim invasion time. And we carry on with it. So if you like, the social dimension is a hereditary hierarchical caste system. The Sati tradition, child marriages, if you like, is a carryover because of the social dimension interfering with the dignity of Hinduism. Please be aware of this.
Thank you, Jaipa. So it is quite an interesting thing because I suppose it's not only with Hinduism. This sort of thing happens with many other religions where something started off with a
good idea,
but it then got twisted and then it became
counterproductive.
Part of how society found it acceptable,
yes,
in a negative way.
That they just carried on mechanically and it became counterproductive, seriously counterproductive.
Brilliant. So folks, thank you so much for joining us. We've got a lot of viewers on YouTube. We've got so many viewers on Facebook as well. Welcome to you all. I will come to your questions one by one. What I'd like to do is just answer a few questions that we've got already from last week's session. And I'll start with that. So, Jaipa, we got a question from Bharat. And Bharat is asking, how do we incorporate spirituality in the education system?
Yes. See, as I said, I've been saying this, a lot of people actually criticize me, saying, Mr. Lakhani, you seem to be kind of anti-Congress and pro-Modi and entering the political scene. Don't do that. I said, I'm not interested in politics. But I'm being very clear we actually, for 5,000 years, this nation was kept together as a single civilization because it embraced higher principles, higher ideals, not material things. Because of that, that nation stood the ground, and that the backbone of that nation was spirituality, focusing on ideals. Story of Ram, story of everything is ideals, living for ideals, not for property, possession, power. So this is how the nation was stayed together as a single civilization on the face of this earth. Very powerful thing. And then after independence, for some foolish reasons, you know, half-baked secularist ideas, we decided to take Hinduism out of the public life. Not only public life, we took it out of the education system. I cannot teach Hinduism in a single Indian school. It is banned. Can you imagine that banning, the central feature of that tradition, banned from the education system? So you say, how do you bring back spirituality? You have to reintroduce the teachings of, I'm not talking about sectarian Hinduism, not talking about some cultish Hinduism, the broad and dynamic vision of Hinduism, give it to your youngsters at school, not after they're grown up and they've started to work in the media. They're already prejudiced against Hinduism anyway. So just at the very young age, just give them the honest, the true, the rational vision of Hinduism from the age of 4, 5, 6. I'm saying just give them colorful story. Give the deeper vision, why ethics and morality are central and so on. And then when these youngsters grow up, become very important, you know, public figures in the media everywhere, then because they have embraced the deeper vision of Hinduism, they will not become anti-Hindu, especially in the media. So the only way we can kind of bring back spirituality is to bring back Hinduism in the education system in India. You can't teach Hinduism in Indian school. Can you believe that? You can teach other, you know, in UK I can teach Hinduism at every school. In India I can't. Can you imagine a nation steeped in spirituality is not allowed to promote spirituality in the education system? This is our problem.
Thank you. Folks, from YouTube I've been getting a few comments that the video is coming in portrait mode. At my end, it is on landscape still. So please, if you could just give me a comment or an update whether you see me still in portrait or on landscape, that would be awesome. This is a live broadcast, so these are some of the challenges we do face with technology, and I would urge you to just bear with us while we sort that out. Now, in the meanwhile, while I wait for your updates, I will ask another question. This is from Bidwan Rath. He's from Odisha in India, and he's saying, I'm confused very much about one thing. If nothing is permanent, then what is the value of one's effort towards humanity if that is also not going to bring about permanent change? So why do spiritual giants do so much for humanity if they also know that their work is not permanent?
You see, in a way, when we are kind of, we live in this world of Maya, if I can use the word, which is a bit of like a, you know, not reality, and yet it appears a reality. We have to play by the rules of Maya. That is why the great personalities play along. Not because they want to, say, okay, I know it's Maya, so why should I bother? They know they have to play the game according to the needs of society. I'll give you an example. See, in Krishna, in the Bhagavad Gita, I think it's chapter 3, Krishna is talking about the karma mag. And he says something very cutting. First of all, he says karma mag is simply saying, make sure you are active by nature. Don't be passive and don't be full of inertia, tamas. He said, be active, first part. Second part, he says, do activity which are spiritually oriented rather than materially oriented. This is the second part. Do action, but selfless action. The third part Krishna mentions in the Karma Yoga is very interesting. He says, look, the great personalities have risen above the idea that this world is for real. They know it. And yet, do you know why they continue to act in this world, even though they've risen above it? To set a good example to the rest of humanity. Because if they decide, okay, I'm going to be withdrawn, who cares? Then the rest of humanity says, if they are not bothered, why should we bother? So it is in a way to stir up greater humanity to kind of not just live in this state of Maya, but to rise above it. But the great personalities have always kind of given the best example. Look, we are above it, and yet we play ball with it. So this is the reason why we carry on. Not because we are, the great personalities have got it wrong. They know, they are fully aware, and yet they continue to interact with the greater society.
So I'd like to just welcome a few people on the broadcast. We've got Ajay Eragram. Thank you very much for your greetings. We've got Srikant. We've got a few others on YouTube. So we've got Karan Rana. We've got Shashank watching us from Germany. We've got Vigneshwari watching us from India. And we've got Namita, Pulkit, I remember you were here on a few broadcasts as well. So welcome all to the Ajay Reddy. Welcome all to the broadcast.
Can I say something, Vishudbhai? There's a youngster called Dhaval Nai who has been trying to arrange a talk for me at the UCL, which is on Monday evening. I'm doing a bit of advertisement, sorry. At UCL at 6:30 p.m. And Dhaval Nai is the youngster at UCL who has organized the talk. And the talk is very interesting, Science and Hinduism. So just giving a free ad.
What is UCL?
University College London. So if you are in other part of the world, sorry my friend, you can't attend. This is near King's Cross, Euston Square, and it's UCL. But anyway, you can go on our Facebook and get the details.
Is it an open event?
Open event, free of charge, open event. And I think it'll be well attended because the topic is very interesting, because the university students love to know how can Hinduism have anything to do with science at all. Surely they are in contradiction, but this is what you are trying to address.
Brilliant. So I'm going to ask now a question from YouTube, and this is from Karan Rana, and he's asking what happens to, I know we've addressed this two or three sessions back, but I'm just going to do it for their benefit. What happens to the soul after death?
Yes. Again, there are three worldviews regarding what happens to any individual when they pass away. The first view comes from the atheistic lobby, the humanist lobby, which says that, look, Mr. Lakhani, we are just here temporarily, we just get snuffed out, full stop, nothing remains. So your individuality, your mind, body, intellect, everything just gets, boom, disappears. So this is the first approach, saying we get snuffed out, full stop. No other discussion, nothing carries on. How can anything carry on? The body is gone. This is one approach. The good thing is it makes you very aware that every moment is precious. This is a good part. You see, you must look at the good part of every particular philosophy.
The moment you're born with a countdown timer.
That's right. You already know, because people sometimes celebrate birthdays. I think if you don't celebrate, you should be very worried that one more year gone. So you perhaps should become kind of more morbid. Enjoy anyway. So this is, if you like, the first approach, the atheistic or the humanist approach. Fair enough. Listen to them. Majority of human beings are like that at the moment. They are atheistic in their views. The second approach is from the Abrahamic tradition, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. They are saying there's a two-life scenario. And there's a bit of a middle ground as well. But the two-life scenario, this one and the next everlasting life, either in heaven or hell. Look, this is their way of thinking. Fair enough. This is the second approach. The third approach comes from the Indic religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism, which says we are born again and again. This sounds like outlandish idea, but we have to subscribe to be a Hindu, Sikh, or Jain, or Buddhist. You have to subscribe to the idea of here we go again, round the merry-go-round. You know, so this is the idea of the Indic tradition that we are born again and again. Two things that I must address immediately. First, you say I don't remember. The answer is really when one life finishes and the next one begins, it's such a disruptive interruption in your life that the memory falls off. So you don't remember your past life, and yet you have lived, your character stays with you in the next life. This is, if you like, the Indic vision.
Okay, brilliant. So folks, once again, just a quick humble request from us. Thank you very much for everybody on Facebook. I can see that we've had more than 40 shares of this video. Please keep it up. Let us spread the word. And I would ask the folks over on YouTube to help us do the same. And I will go back again to YouTube for another question. And this is from Karan Rana again. What is the importance of Bhagavad Gita in one's life?
Very important. You see, suppose you ask a Hindu, what is the main scripture in your tradition? There will be fumble. They'll say maybe Ramayana, maybe this and that, Bhagavad Puran or something. But I, as an academic, will say, if you really want to kind of capture the essence of Hinduism in one textbook, then the 700 verses of the Bhagavad Gita is perhaps the best place to look. Because here you see a reconciliation of a variety of different approaches in spirituality in the time of Krishna. He managed to reconcile the various approaches that were visible in the Upanishads. So the Upanishads are so many that he managed to kind of reconcile the teachings of the Upanishads. This is the high philosophy of Hinduism regarding our essential nature as Atman, the essential nature of creation as Brahman. This is what he did. So this is why it's a reconciliation of wonderful philosophic ideas in one textbook. The second thing, important thing in the Bhagavad Gita is this. It is not only talking about the theory of Hinduism, it is telling you how to put it into practice. This is why it's a beautiful text. Because the Upanishads are philosophic, but Krishna turns them into a very like a workable kind of model. So that is why Bhagavad Gita in a way brings religion into your daily life. It says the battle we have is not in the Kurukshetra. In our daily life we have to fight a lot of issues. And this is why this idea of Bhagavad Gita is very crucial. It allows us to address the human condition and kind of tell us how to lead our normal human life, you know, worldly life. This is why it's a powerful text. So I would say if you are happy with Bhagavad Gita, you don't need to look anywhere. But look, for me, my Bhagavad Gita is Swami Vivekananda, but that is my personal take.
Brilliant. So I now move over to Facebook viewer Srikant Rajan, whose question is on a recent topical issue. So there's the mandir called Sabarimala, and there's a big issue about women not being allowed entry into the temple.
Okay.
So he says, why are people not accepting change, and what are your views about the current scenario with this?
I've been asked this question again and again on various, you know, social media, and I've deliberately kept quiet. I tell you why I've kept quiet. If I'm not sure regarding what are the exact issues, it's better for me not to step in and start, you know, babbling on. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you some of the things that I've heard, just for general knowledge. First of all, South India is a matriarchal society, tremendous respect to women. Lots of temples that are devoted to mother goddesses, South India. It's a matriarchal society. Northern India is mostly patriarchal, you know, Ram and all this, you know, men. But South India has always been matriarchal, a very strong matriarchal society. So it's not that they are compromising the position of women in society. They already recognize them as the mother goddesses. Mm-hmm. Here, you see, it is much more to do with social. Again, this is a social dimension of religion. Now, that particular part of the temple, etc., has been traditionally a place where only men go in. Now, it's a kind of a quirk. I can use the word quirk. So if this quirk is an essential aspect of the temple authority or the people running the temple, who am I from London putting my finger up and say, oh, you mustn't do that? It is their business, really. So that's why I say I've kept quiet about it, because there may be a lot of social, lot of cultural, lot of kind of very mundane issues that are involved, social issues that I don't know much about. So it is better for me to keep my mouth shut and not to try and say this is right or this is wrong. We know women are to be given equal dignity, but look, if there is one little enclave where there's only men, what's the big deal? You know, I mean, if you go into the, sorry, I should use the language like that, but there are some places only men for men, so leave it, don't compromise everything. But at the same time, I'm not saying women have to be compromised and they can't go because they are lower or something, nothing of the sort. In fact, South India sees women as number one, the higher gender.
I see this as like one of the things we talked about, the social dimensions of Hinduism. So this is one of those things where society says this is the way it has to be.
Yes.
Which is not necessarily the best way it has to be.
But it's become stuck.
Because it's a societal thing, it will take a bit of time for people to change. The hardest thing for people to do is change. And so I would say keep pressing on and keep the issue burning, and things will change in its own time. But in the meanwhile, let's move on to the next question. So the next question is from Ajay Eragram, and this is, he's asking, I would like to know the difference in Neo-Vedanta and Advaita Vedanta, which is the better way of the two?
Okay, Vedanta is Vedanta. So this kind of classification that we've seen recently, it came after Vivekananda. Because Vivekananda's presenting is kind of more dynamic vision of Vedanta, suited to our own time, you know, seeing and serving God in humanity and all these kind of materials. So this came out of Vivekananda, and this in a way rattled the traditionalists. You know, there's always traditionalists, even in philosophy. So the traditionalist Vedantis, you know, Advaita Vedantis said, this is like a compromise, you know, this is not following Adi Shankara, he's kind of producing his own stuff. So they call it Neo-Vedanta.
And new version.
But the thing is, in a way, they're demeaning it. They're kind of denigrating it, saying it's not real, genuine stuff. It's kind of newer stuff, you know, kind of a new kid on the block kind of stuff. In reality, I'm telling you, Neo-Vedanta is the real Vedanta, and Adi Shankara Vedanta is antique Vedanta. Sorry. So Advaita Vedanta, according to me, is antique Vedanta, while Neo-Vedanta of Vivekananda is the dynamic Vedanta suited to Vedanta is just Vedanta, conclusion of the Vedas, the conclusion of the teaching of Vedas. What is our essential nature? What is the essential nature of the universe? How are we interconnected? This is the idea of Vedanta. And whether you call it Neo or Advaita, I leave it to you. But I say I prefer this idea of modern version of Advaita Vedanta that came with Vivekananda.
My fellow viewers, thank you so much for joining us. What I'd like to say is thank you so much for your contributions. Questions like these are the ones we are looking for. So let us know what you'd like to be finding out more about on Hinduism in the comments area. And what I'll do is I'll go over to one of the older questions that we've got. And this is from Aman. And he's saying, there is a lot of talk about the universe not being alone. There are now multiverses. So his question is this. If there are multiverses, there's a likelihood of a higher form of life or a more advanced civilization sort of than us. So what is the possibility of being reincarnated into another totally different universe in a different sort of life form that's even a higher life form than this?
Okay, first of all, let me just touch on the word multiverses, because people get confused. It's nothing to do with the Hindu teachings that you see in Vashishtha Ramayana, you know, this idea of different dimensions of reality. First of all, the multiverse scenario that came into modern physics simply said, as the quantum phenomena is so weird, we rather say that while I'm talking to you, while we are talking to each other, the universe is making infinite copies of itself at every infinitesimal moment, because one electron jumps slightly differently. This is called the multiverse scenario. This is, you know, divergence with a vengeance. This is nothing with Hinduism. So when people think somehow link it with multiverses, no, multiverse is a cop-out by modern physics to try and address the issue of, you know, this quantum, which is a real serious problem. So they're just falling back on multiverse scenario. And when they did a survey recently in one of the European cities, where all the theoretical physicists got together, majority of physicists were not prepared to go along with multiverse. It's incredible. They are not. They say it's a cop-out. It's not right. So this is, if you like, the physics side. Multiverse has nothing with Hinduism. It's a different game. Now, what is the Hindu take? Hinduism says, and always said this, that we may think that the world that we encounter, the world, the material world we see, we meet each other, we are quite sure about the reality in front of us. Nishit Bhai and I say, oh, this is the camera, this is it. So we are quite sure about an objective reality and we can exist in this particular field. Now, the Hindu take is this. He says, yeah, you may think this is all perfectly fine. The reason why you agree on why this is a chair or a table, etc., or why you can communicate, is because you are using the same mindset, or if you like, mind, a cosmic mind we share,
collective
mind, which allows us to individualize it, saying this is from my angle, I see it this way, from his angle, oh, it looks like this, like, you know, like different cameras viewing the same thing from different angles.
So we are validating it.
That's it. But the only thing we all feel, there's still a real physical reality to this world, but we are, if you like, we are sharing the same mind. That is why we can agree and why we can communicate. Just imagine. So this is the idea that is very important in Hinduism. But then the Hinduism says this. It says, just as you are sure about this universe and this creation, and in this mindset or this particular cosmic mind, there can be other levels of existence which are higher and lower, both. We agree with that. This is, has been a Hindu philosophy aspect to us. So we agree that there are higher states of existence where perhaps you have less cantorous people, perhaps less cantorous encounters, and you may, after you pass away, enter one of these higher states of, you know, consciousness or levels of existence. And it is acceptable in Hindu tradition. That's why we talk about Devlok and this idea of Devilok and stuff like that. I personally think it is real, because to think that this is the only reality is in a way kind of mean. There may be other realities too. You must accept. I have not touched it, I haven't experienced it, but I think it is a rational idea.
Brilliant. Folks, thank you so much. Now, I'll move on to a question from Srikant Rajan. And he also has a comment on this. He was saying, before I ask his question, he's saying, there is a
Heisenberg uncertainty principle.
Yeah, is he saying, does that have roots in Hinduism?
No. The only good thing about, let me tell you, there are three fathers of quantum mechanics. Three fathers. If you got three fathers, any child has got three fathers, that would be a weird child. And quantum mechanics is absolutely right. It's weirdest of the weird. Now, the three fathers are Niels Bohr, Werner Heisenberg, the one who talk about Heisenberg's uncertain principle, and the third one is Erwin Schrodinger. Now, these are lovely people. When you look at their private lives, a bit of monkey business, but they were very, very clear thinkers and very powerful physicists. Now, they came across the idea of quantum. This is how they got together as a club, and it rattled them to their bones, because the reason is this. Quantum physics is saying the material world you're so sure about is an appearance, and that's underpinning it is non-material, but it appears as material. Now, this is like, if you're a materialist, this matter you're so fixed on is just appearance, is a secondary phenomena, something deeper, is a go away. They won't agree with that. I have this experience at Eton College. You know, the humanist tutor there said, Mr. Lakhani, I can't agree with that. I said, fair enough. So this is the finding of, at the heart of physical science, physics. This is a deeper reality to the world that we encounter. Now, one of the great kind of proponents is Erwin Schrodinger. He's the first person perhaps to kind of produce a mathematical formalism for explaining the quantum phenomena with quantum equations, all that, psi function, all this kind of stuff. Now, he was a very interesting person. He loved the Upanishads. And at one time he said, not that he is borrowed from India or from Hinduism, but he was a great admirer of the Upanishads. And he said, The only way we can resolve the issue of quantum, these are his words, is by kind of focusing on Eastern metaphysics. And of course, you're talking about the Upanishads. So one of them was very strongly attracted to Hinduism, not all three. And by the way, Werner Heisenberg, the Heisenberg principle, he visited India and stayed with Tagore and loved Tagore, and they were talking all the time. Tagore is a poet, mind you, not a physicist, but you know, he loved him. And so Werner Heisenberg also had tremendous affinity for Hinduism. That's all I can say. The third one, Niels Bohr, had affinity for the idea of Tao of his, you know, Tao, the idea of the Far Eastern idea of, you know, yin and yang. So he was attracted to think that by using yin and yang, he can explain quantum. So he was focusing on that. But these two others were very strongly connected with India and Hinduism. But I'm not saying they borrowed from India. What they've discovered, in a way, you know, agrees with the deeper vision that Hinduism always been promoting.
Brilliant. So, coming to Srikant's question, it was this. He said he recently read a book by Dr. Brian Weiss on reincarnation through sleep hypnosis. So, if by hypnosis we can view our past reincarnation, there is a fear of attachment to that past. Should we continue to go down that path?
Okay, this is a good question to explore. Initially, the research on reincarnation by Professor Ian Stevenson, the main person who done the work, was through hypnotic regression. So what he'll do is this. He'll take a patient and say, okay, I'm going to put you to sleep, and now I'm going to ask you to go back in time. So the person will say, oh, I'm a young man, I'm at school, oh, I'm a little baby, and go, ga, 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 ga. He'll start talking like that. He said, no. Stevenson will say, go back further. Who are you? He goes back and says, oh, I'm not this person. I'm somebody else. Oh, I'm in France, and now I'm a very important nobleman in France. So these kind of things used to happen. And then Professor Stevenson would ask him all sorts of questions about who he is in the past life and record it, and then try and see if it actually matches up with some personality who lived in that particular period, or what he talks about makes sense. He tried to do that, but in no time, this is the interesting part, he decided to give that up. This is the reason. In hypnotic regression, you may actually, one in 100 perhaps, or one in 10 perhaps, will be actually able to go back to the past life. Not this is a good idea, but they might be able to do that, and sometimes they can resolve their issues by going in the past life. Let me touch on that. I think it's important. Sometimes, you know, what can happen is this. In your past life, you may have had a very traumatic experience. And you're hiding there. Suppose you got burnt, or, you know, you kind of had this
repressed sort of,
you know, your inner being. So when you go into hypnotic regression, you are allowed to release this. This kind of pent up kind of emotions are released.
You can come to terms with it.
And then you see, you come back to this life, and those fears, for example, fire or water, are resolved.
Okay.
So this is why it has been used medically to kind of resolve serious mental issues some human beings suffer with. That is perfectly fine. But again, this is just, if you like, the medical side of it. The real problem is this. Professor Stevenson found that majority of people were asked to do, you know, put in hypnotic regression, were actually doing daydreaming. So they're conjuring up, because suppose they loved Napoleon, they loved Cleopatra. They thought they were Cleopatra in their past life. So he had half a dozen Cleopatras in hypnotic regression. They can't all be right. Something is seriously wrong. So because he realized that a lot of people actually continue to go in the hypnotic regression and start creating their own world, hypnotic, you know, kind of a make-believe world, you know, daydreaming, you can't trust that. So he stopped that straight away. Very clever man. So he said, no, this is producing a lot of daydreaming, passing of his past life. I don't have time for that. So he stopped doing research on hypnotic regression and focused on little children who remember their past life spontaneously. No hypnotic regression. Just remember their past life. He would challenge them, question them, and check out if the lives, if the, this what they are talking about actually exists. Somebody did live that like that, you know, 20, 30, 50 years ago. This is proper research. So he gave up hypnotic regression and kind of went into the idea of children remembering their past life. This is the beautiful way this particular research was done. Now, one of the questions you pose is this. Is it good or bad? I would say, look, if it's resolved some serious, you know, emotional issues that you have at this moment and you get released from it, it's good in that way. But it's bad in the following way, because in a way it also kind of like opening the can of worms. So a lot of things that you are kind of bubbling up in your past life that you would rather not, you know, revisit, you might as well not go down that line and live this life fully and focus on here and now rather than focus on lots of previous lives where God knows what kind of life you had led.
Brilliant. Folks, thank you so much for joining us. Paula, watching us on YouTube, I hope this answers your question, which was about how you can find out more about your past life. And I'd like just to say hello to Pulkit, to Gautam Jain, Paula, like I said, Akash Bitlani, Harmeet. So Harmeet's got an interesting question. Harmit Singh, he's watching us from Lithuania in Europe. He's saying, could you please explain a little bit about, is this Nasariya Sukta?
Nasariya Sukta, yeah.
From the Rig Veda, saying, in his opinion, that's the most common thing about God in all religions. What's your take on it?
Nasariya Sukta is one of these beautiful, you know, very ancient Vedic scriptures that in a way gives a deeper dimension to reality and kind of talks about how did it all start. This is the position of Nasariya Sukta. It starts saying, this is kind of, it's a poetic thing as well, it's not purely philosophy, it's poetic. It starts off by saying, darkness covered darkness. Now how do you explain that in real life? So darkness was covering darkness. And nothing, he existed without breathing, he was breathing like that. This is how it starts. So it's talking about how did this creation come into being? And this is the Nasariya Sukta. But the cutting part of Nasariya Sukta, which I like, is this. In a way it is talking about, I don't think it will agree with many religions, it is talking about the idea that this creation is very likely a spontaneous thing. So there was no God sitting in heaven, clicking a button and saying, okay, let's start. So it is, I would agree with modern cosmology, that it's a spontaneous creation. This agrees with modern physics, modern cosmology, and I like it as well. Because the idea of a God, kind of somewhere, some individual, like, ding, I start, kind of offend my common sense. Because then how did he start? What is his foundation? What is his background? Why does he create? All these issues arise, and if he's a human figure, a superhuman figure, he's in trouble. So I rather focus on this spontaneous creation that comes with modern cosmology. And the end verse of the Nasariya Sukta, it says very cuttingly, it says, this, how this came about, this thing of darkness covering darkness turning into this world, how did this come about? Perhaps he in the highest heaven knows, or perhaps he came afterwards. You know, this is a philosophically very height of philosophy, saying idea of God is something that we create, not God create us, we create God.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Jaybhai, for answering the questions. Folks, please keep them coming. I will ask one more question, then we will close in the next 5 minutes or so. So this question is from Naman Jaman. I hope I got that right. He's saying, Jaybhai, what is the truth about the memory of water? So yes. Scientists don't seem to accept this, yet there are Nobel Prize winners like Luc Montagnier who claims that it may be true. Indians have always worshipped sacred water of Ganges or Ganga.
Now, you see, Nishibai, you actually asked me this question, remember?
We have you spoken about on this, yes.
And Nishibai said there is a real experiment going on that in a way, you know, water in a way has a kind of, not a memory, but a habit of interacting with reality, almost in a spiritual way. And some professors have been kind of working on it and say how thoughts, etc. can affect the way the water kind of makes it appear and so on. Now, look, this is a technical thing and I don't really have that kind of 100% knowledge about it to really comment very honestly. But it's nice that we recognize, look, fire, water, earth, you know, wind, this is the standard way the whole of humanity kind of try to relate to reality. Whole of the humanity in these five elements we talk about, you know, fire, water, solid, liquid, gas, fire and ether are kind of standard way humanity has been trying to relate to reality. And water is, of course, one of the central one. It's in fact, it's a life-giving thing that we have. In fact, in, you know, furthest planets, when they're looking for life, they're looking for water because that will be the signal there can be life there.
Okay, fine. So Jaybhai, I'm going to ask you a question. So viewers, this is the time where I ask Jaybhai a googly. It's a question that he doesn't really know. He's not expecting it, but it's just something that I like to throw a curveball at him. And so Jaybhai, if everybody spoke their mind, would this world be a better place?
Look, see, we are social animals. You try and do that, I'm telling you, try and do that. In fact, I said in one of my earlier talks.
I'm envisaging a scenario of Trump and the North Korean leader speaking their minds freely.
Trouble. they'll both fire missiles at each other in no time. Look, you see, we have to recognize we are individuals as well as social animals. So in a way, we have to, in a way, make sure that we don't step on other toes and upset other people. So the nice thing that we hear in the Hindu tradition is that, okay, be always truthful, but always be sweet in the way you express yourself. And don't be truthful just, you know, just for the sake of being truthful and kind of, you know, in a way hurt somebody. So be very careful. The only thing is, if we all start speaking our mind, I think the world, you may think we'll be better, but I got a feeling that it'll be more cantorous, because then you'll offend your friends in no time. Suppose somebody knocks on your door, or your best friend, and you're kind of dozy, and you open the door and say, "Aren't you pleased to see me?" And you say, "Of course I'm pleased to see you." Saying nothing, doing, "I hate you, go away." So once you start doing that, you lose all your friends very quickly if you tell your mind. But sometimes you have to be stickler for truth. At the same time, be very careful. You are a social animal. You have to live with other human beings.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Joel Jaipai, for answering the question. It's always interesting to see a fresh take on questions that I'm interested in, and I get nuggets from Jaipai, as I'm sure most of you do as well. So we are coming to the close of this session for today. I will ask one final question, then we will bring it to a close. The question here is from Jasmin Sachdev. And he's saying, do we meet our past loved ones in the afterlife?
Okay. Yes, majority of Hindus will actually, majority of human beings, I would say, according to my own thinking, will end up in what is called Pitru Lok. Between one life and another life, you've got a kind of a bit of a break. So we create, in a way, kind of inhabit a world that is, in a way, not clear cut like this, but in much more like a mental state, where we kind of encounter the people who have passed away in our own families, fathers and forefathers and relations and friends who passed away. So we do actually go enter that state. It's called Pitri Lok. Major human beings end up there because they feel like there's tremendous attachment to the people who passed away, and they're not reincarnated, so they're still sticking around, and they kind of share this vision, like a dream vision, where you kind of interact with the people who passed away. This for real. This, I believe it's true. Do you know why I'm so sure? A lot of research done by Professor Stevenson also said the same. A lot of people, you know, talk about near-death experience. You may have heard about that. Where many of them, the Westerners, not the Hindus, the Westerners, atheists, whoever, talk about almost dying, giving up their body, and then entering a state where they meet the people who passed away in their own families. Incredible material has been researched. I think 2,000 case scenarios of near-death experience at Southampton University. So they're done tremendous research. Mm-hmm. And one of the interesting things is a lot of them recall an experience after they were, you know, declared dead, of meeting their dead relatives and embracing them, seeing them. Sometimes the relatives say, "Go away, you're too early, go back," and so on. And very interesting material kind of pops out from there. And of course, the hard-headed scientists say, "We don't believe in stuff like that." Mr. Lakhani says, "Nonsense, all kind of, you know, your mind kind of about to switch off and kind of conjures up all this imagery. It's not real." But there's one interesting example that really touched me is this. One man had a near-death experience. He came back in his body and they asked, he said, "I had a near-death experience. I saw our dead relatives, all the family friends who passed away were there, and I saw them all, and then I came back." And then he said, "But by the way, I also met this uncle there." And he, according to him, the uncle was still alive. He says, "I don't know why, but I saw this uncle there as well. And that surprised me." And the family said, "My friend, don't you know, last week he passed away." So he already joined the club. So a very interesting way of saying this is not just make-believe, because he didn't know the person is still, you know, has passed away. And in the near-death experience, he saw him in that other realm. So it's an interesting way. And of course, the hard-headed scientist was just a coincidence, Mr. Lakhani, don't go down that line. So be it. This is our take. So we believe, yes, there is a Pitru Lok, and most of us will end up there. But it's not a very good place. I'm not saying it's a bad place, but simply because what do you do there? You embrace your, you know, past relatives. What do you do? When they're alive, you should interact with them while they're here, not after they're gone. So it's best to interact with your relatives here and now, rather than wait to go to a Pitru Lok and then embrace them. I think we should finish with that.
Brilliant. So folks, thank you so much for joining the broadcast today. We really appreciate your participation, your comments, the way you're helping us to share the broadcast. What I'd like you to do is, if you're on Facebook, please consider visiting our YouTube page. It's youtube.com/HinduAcademy. Hit the subscribe button, hit the bell button, so that you are informed of the next broadcast that we upload. And if you're on Facebook, please consider joining us on Facebook. If you're on YouTube, get to facebook.com/HinduAcademy, where you will be updated of the links to the next broadcast, etc. You will be able to join the conversation over there. I will close now. Jaybhai, do you have any final questions?
Yes, Nishit, let me make two comments.
Yes.
One of my close friends, Ashok, I said, Dilipbhai, Jaybhai, speak slowly. You're going at double speed. I can't help myself. I'm going to I try my best. Every time I speak, I said, Ashok, why slow down? And there's another friend, Manish Bhai, he said, Mr. Lakhani, close the window in front of your eyes because you're getting a glare in your glasses. So look, I'll close that as well. And the third person, Jay Shank, said, Mr. Lakhani, wear a tie. Otherwise, look like riffraff. So I'm doing that as well. So I'm following the friend's advice. And any more advice coming from me, I'll welcome it. Thank you, my friends.
So for YouTube viewers, I do apologize. I can see the broadcast is in portrait mode. So it's not the best viewing format for you. If you view in full screen and turn the phone around, that will help. Next time, we will make sure that we address these technical difficulties. In closing, I'd like to just quote Swami Vivekananda again. And he says, all differences in this world are of degree, not of kind. Because oneness is the secret of everything.
Wonderful.
So you've been a great audience. Thank you so much. We will see you next week on Saturday, 2:00 UK time. Bye-bye for now.